There's no teleprompter.
There is no teleprompter.
Yeah.
They're going old school, they got notes.
Good. A few shouts made it happen. 4 hours and counting on my feet, waiting for the President of the United States. And it's hold on. This is about rock or pop. Can I say work? Having a ball with old friends and me. Shout out.
Free Ron Hood, hold you down for a ball.
It's the vision President Obama fights for each day.
And it's understandable that at a certain point people just say, you know what,
there's a disconnect here. This is not speaking to me. It's not speaking to what's going on in my neighborhood, my community. But I just want to remind everybody that, you know, in 2008, there were a lot of folks who didn't believe either, and the possibilities have changed. There were folks that counted us out. People who were sure that a guy named Barack Obama could not be elected president. And so the reason we came together was not because we thought it was a sure thing. It was because we shared a set of values. We believed in the basic bargain that has been the bedrock of this nation for well over 200 years. And, you know, I was thinking, as I was about to come out, about this, which will be my last campaign.
Change the rules.
There's a term limit thing.
Change the rules.
This isn't like conference. I can't just keep on running. My earliest campaigns, and the reason I got into politics in the first place. You know, some of you know my grandparents were part of that World War II Great Depression generation. And my grandfather fought in Patton's Army, and my grandmother worked on a bomber assembly line. And when my grandfather came back, at that point my mom had been born, he was able to go to college because of the GI Bill. And they were able to buy their first home with some help from the FHA. And then my mother, you know, she was a single mom. My dad left before I even remembered. But she was still able to give me and my sister this unbelievable education. Because of scholarships and grants.
Uh-huh.
And the fact that she was willing to work hard so that she could work and go to school at the same time and raise two kids. Then I think about Michelle's family. You know, her dad, he was a blue-collar worker, worked at the water filtration plant in Chicago.
No.
And even though he had MS, so he, by the time I met him, he couldn't really walk. He had to use two canes. And he'd have to wake up an hour earlier than everybody else, get to work, just to put on his clothes and get ready for work. But he never missed a day's work. And Michelle's mom, she stayed at home and looked after Michelle and her brother until they got older, and then worked as a secretary most of her life. And yet, despite these modest beginnings, Michelle and her brother Craig could go to the best schools on earth. And rise up to do extraordinary things. So, in my first campaign, when I thought about why am I getting into politics, the reason was because my family, Michelle's family, we had benefited from this basic American bargain. This idea at the heart of this nation, that if you're willing to work hard, if you are willing to take responsibility, then you're not constrained by the circumstances of your birth. You can go as far as your dreams can take you. If you're willing to work hard, then you can find a job that supports a family. And you can have a home to call your own. When you get sick. Yeah. And even if you weren't born into wealth, you can make sure your kids get a great education and go on to college. Yeah. Maybe you can take vacation once in a while. I was up in Ohio talking about, you know, My favorite vacation, when I was 11 years old, my grandmother, my mother, my sister and me, we traveled the country. But we didn't do it on jets.
All right.
I just did.
We took Greyhound.
Not a jet.
I think twice we rented a car.
One third jet.
And we stayed at Howard Johnson's. And if there was a pool somewhere, no matter, it could look like a puddle that it could be so small. I was excited about it.
Yes.
And, you know, you'd go to the ice machine and the vending machine.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I was 11 years old. That was a big deal. Filled up that bucket of ice. And the point was that your vacation didn't have to be fancy. It just gave you a sense of how you could spend time with each other.
It's your family.
That was part of that American dream.
Woo!
And then the notion that you could retire with dignity and respect after a lifetime of work. That's the idea that got me into politics. Because my feeling was, given how much this country had given me and given Michelle, I wanted to make sure that that same bargain held for the next generation. But it wasn't just about me, it was about making sure that every American had those same opportunities. And the interesting thing is, when I first started running for the U.S. Senate, let's say in Illinois, and I'd be driving around, and we'd go to downstate Illinois, small farm towns, and sometimes we'd be in the big cities like Chicago. No matter who you met, they had those same stories in their background. They, black, white, Latino, Asian, they remembered their parents or their grandparents or great-grandparents, some of them immigrants, some of them, brought here. Not by choice, but each successive generation believing that this union could be perfected and that if they really worked hard, were able to overcome whatever barriers in their way, that they could succeed. So I ran in 2008 because I felt that bargain wasn't reaching enough people. The reason so many of you supported me in 2008 was because you understood that dream was slipping away for too many people. That we had gone through a decade in which wages and incomes weren't going up no matter how hard you worked. While the cost of everything from college to healthcare and groceries and gas kept on going up.
Literally.
And people worrying that maybe their kids might not do as well as they did, when the idea was always that your kids do better than you do.
Yes.
And so that's what brought us together. The campaign in 2008 was not about a single candidate. It wasn't about me, it was about us. Since the Great Depression. Millions of people thrown out of work, folks losing the value of their homes. And so, in some ways, that dream seemed even further away. But you know, we've worked hard over the last 3.5 years to try to restore that belief that in this country, you can make it if you try.
You're fine.
That's how we were able to save an auto industry when some said, let Detroit go bankrupt. We said, we're going to bet on American workers and American industry. And now GM is back on top. Getting back to basics, and we've now created more than 4.4 million new jobs. More than 500,000 manufacturing jobs. job created during this time. You know, we've seen all across the country folks who got laid off, retrained, go back to a community college, and be able to find a new job in a new industry. Small businesses struggling, sometimes keeping their doors open, even though they're not taking a salary, because they know their employees depend on them and their families depend on them. It's turned out that America's tougher than any tough times. But what we also understand is we still got more work to do, because Virginia, the reason I ran and the reason you supported me wasn't just to get back to where we were in 2007.
To go forward.
The reason we came together was to restore that promise for middle class families and all who are striving to get into the middle class. Because after 3.5 years of not getting much help from the other side.
All right.
We know.
That's not my name. They just call it the other side. I think what I'm trying to say is that we now have a stalemate in Washington.
Yeah.
Solving our problems, making sure that good jobs are created here in the United States, making sure that those good jobs pay and have basic benefits, making sure that we're bringing down our deficit in a responsible way, making sure that we maintain cutting-edge industries here in the United States, making sure we've got the best education system possible. We know how to do those things.
Yeah.
What's holding us back is not an absence of new ideas. It's not a lack of solutions. It's the fact that there are two fundamentally different visions about how we move this country forward.
Yeah.
So this election is about more than just two candidates or two political parties, Virginia. This is about which direction we take this nation. Now, you know, the other side, Mr. Romney and his allies in Congress, they've got a very particular idea about how we move this country forward.
It
basically involves taking the country back. Their economic idea, you can summarize it really easily. They basically want to give $5 trillion in new tax cuts, mostly for the wealthy, on top of the Bush tax cuts. Even if it means gutting investments in education, even if it means gutting investments in basic research, even if it means that we're not rebuilding America's infrastructure, even if it starts cutting into benefits that we're providing to our veterans. The basic idea is that if you help folks at the top, at the very top, and if you eliminate regulations that we put in place to make sure banks can just do whatever they want, or consumers aren't cheated by their credit card companies, or insurance companies can't take advantage of their customers, eliminate those regulations, cut taxes at the very top, that somehow all those benefits are going to trickle down on you. That the economy is going to improve and you are going to benefit. Now, I have to tell you, I think they're wrong. I think the wrong Virginia is because we tried. We tried it for most of the last decade. And what were the results? We ended up turning record surpluses into record deficits. Wages, incomes stagnated. Job growth sluggish. And it culminated in the worst financial crisis that we've seen since the 1930s. Now, if you try something and it doesn't work, why would you try it again? from the middle out. From the bottom up.
Tax cut, that'll be settled in the next election, and I'm looking forward to having a debate
Because if you say you want to bring down the deficit, but you're not willing to let tax cuts fall for the top 2%, it tells me you're not serious about deficit reduction.
Yeah.
But we can have that debate. But in the meantime, let's go ahead and help middle class families right now. And so far, I have not gotten an okay from the other side on that. And that tells me, I guess they're not that serious about that super
deficit. Said the abuse of capitalism.
but this is just an example of their broader theory. They think that if you just help wealthy investors, it helps everybody. I think the opposite. Let's take small businesses. I've cut small business taxes 18 times since I've been in office. And by the way, 97% of small businesses make $250,000 a year or less. So for 97% of small businesses, they also benefit if we went ahead and got that done right now. So far, they haven't taken me up on this offer. But what this shows is the difference in philosophy. Because I believe that if you're doing well, then the country does well. I believe in the small business person and the teacher, the construction worker, and you know, the firefighter, all those folks who put in a hard day's work every
day. So far away.
If they're doing well, then everybody does well. That's my vision for America.
I didn't know.
And that's why I'm running for a second term as president. I've got a plan to hire new teachers, especially in math and science.
We've
already expanded the Pell Grant program to help make college more affordable, provide tax credits to middle class families to help make college more affordable. I want to keep on going and make sure that 2 million more people can go to community colleges to get trained in the jobs that exist right now. I don't think the auto industry is unique. I think there are a whole bunch of companies who we can attract back to the United States, but we're going to have to change our tax code and stop giving tax breaks to companies that ship jobs overseas. Those tax breaks are companies that are moving back here. Virginia, who have served us in uniform with such bravery and dedication.
And they make way less than $250,000 most of them do.
And I want us to keep faith with our troops and make sure that our veterans get the benefits that they have earned. And families like Whitney's are getting the help that they need when their loved ones are fighting on our behalf. Woo! A part of keeping faith is also making sure that we've got a smart national security strategy. And it also means making sure that we've got a strong economy to support a strong military. In 2008, I promised we would end the war in Iraq, and we've ended it. Woo! Woo! We are transitioning in Afghanistan. That we've gotten from winding down these wars, use half of it to pay for the deficit, use the other half to do some nation building here at home. Let's put Americans back to work, rebuilding our roads and our bridges, building broadband lines in the rural areas, making sure that we've got the best airports and the best rail lines in the world. That's why I'm running for President of the United States. Policy in the world here in the United States. I also want us to take the lead in clean energy. We've seen oil production go up. We're seeing natural gas production go up. And we've doubled our investment and production in solar and wind and biodiesel. I don't want us to be dependent on what happens in the Middle East for our energy. And double down our investment in clean energy that's never been more promising.
Yeah.
In solar and wind and biodiesel, and put people back to work so that we can free ourselves from dependence on foreign oil. And build up America. That's why I'm running for Secretary.
Four more years! Four more years! Four more years!
And I'm running so that we bring down our deficit and our debt in a balanced, responsible way. You know, we've already made a lot of tough cuts to the federal government, and I'm prepared to do more. I don't believe that every government program works. I don't believe that government is the answer for every problem. You know, we're not going to improve our schools unless our parents are focused on education. Americans can't be looking for handouts. You know, there are some folks who can't help if they're not willing to help themselves.
All right, all right.
But what I also believe is that there are some investments like in education, or in basic research, or in transportation. They're basic investments we need to make to grow our economy. And so if we're going to bring down our deficit in a sensible way that grows the economy and grows our middle class, it can't be based simply on cuts to basic programs and asking nothing from those who have been the most fortunate in this society. So what I said is we'll make cuts, but we're also going to ask the wealthiest Americans like me to do a little bit more. And I promise you we can afford it. And by the way, the last time we did that, it worked. Bill Clinton did it. And we ended up having 23 million new jobs. We went from deficit to surplus. And we created a whole bunch of millionaires to boot. So don't tell me that that's going to destroy jobs. That's going to create jobs, because we're doing it in a way that focuses on building the middle class. And there are a whole bunch of wealthy Americans who understand that and are willing to do the right thing. If they're asked, and I'm prepared to ask them. That's why I'm running for president. and the way we're going to get it done is by you making a decision. There are people who agree with Mr. Romney and his allies in Congress. That's how our democracy works. You know, even though the theory that they are promoting, they tried, and it didn't work, they want to try it again. That's the way our democracy works. But you know what? I'm betting that the American people, they don't want to go backwards. You don't want to refight the fight we had in healthcare. Let me tell you, healthcare was the right thing to do. Make sure that it's even more secure and insurance companies can jerk you around.
That's right.
It allows young people to stay on their parents' health insurance plan. 6 million young people have already gotten it. It lowers prescription drug costs for
seniors.
It guarantees preventive care for everybody, including women. $30 million people are going to be able to get health insurance that didn't have it before, and that means and we'll help them get it.
Thank you, bro.
And the only thing that we have said is if you can afford to get health insurance and you don't, you can't pass those costs on to somebody else.
Right.
You've got to take responsibility. That's part of the American way.
Yeah.
So we're not going to refight that battle. I noticed the House of Representatives, the Republicans in the House of Representatives, they voted to repeal it again. That was the 33rd time they've done that.
Yeah.
33 votes. To repeal the health care bill, all it would take is one vote to make sure that all of you don't see your taxes go up next year. You tell me what would be a better use of time. Mr. Romney doesn't think we should have a timetable for getting out of Afghanistan. I disagree. I don't want to go backwards. I want to go forward. The other side says they want to go back to the days when you could not serve the country you love because of who you love. I disagree.
Yeah! Woo! Woo! Yeah! Yeah!
Mr. Romney says undocumented workers in this country should self-deport. My belief is that we are a nation of laws and a nation of immigrants, and I want to make sure that we get comprehensive immigration reform that gives young people who've been raised here a chance to live out their American dream. I don't want to go backwards, I want to go forward. All these things that I'm talking about, it all goes back to that first campaign I ran. It all goes back to my family and your family and this basic idea of how we make sure that the middle class is strong and growing in this country. How do we make sure that folks who aren't quite there yet, if they work hard enough to get into that sense of security and take care of their families? And you know what? We have learned from our history that that's done together. Well, when previous generations funded the GI Bill, or built the Hoover Dam and the Golden Gate Bridge, or sent a man to the moon, or invested in the basic research that created the internet, they didn't do that because it was going to benefit one person or a handful of people or one group. They did it because they understood we rise or fall together as one people. And that's how I want to move this country forward, together, as one people. And that's why I'm running again as President of the United States. If I'm going to get there, I'm going to meet you.
Here I am, baby!
The way this
Signed, sealed, and delivered.
The choice is going to be up to you. And over the next 4 months, you are going to see more negative ads than you've ever seen in your life.
Okay. Yeah.
You're going to start getting out that DVR and block them out. Fast forward. All that stuff. And you know, the other side, they basically just have one argument, which is the economy's not where it should be, and it's Obama's fault. And they'll just keep on repeating that over and over again, because they know they don't have new ideas. They know the American people wouldn't just buy what they're selling on its own. So they don't want to talk about what they're going to do, they just want to talk about what hasn't gotten done. And you know, that may be a way to try to win an election, but it's not a plan to create jobs. It's not a plan to strengthen the middle class. And I don't care how much money they spend. What you taught me in 2008 is that when regular folk, when working people, when all of you tap into that basic decency and goodness of the American people, when you focus on what's true and what's right, and you cut through all the nonsense and all the noise and all the spin, and you remember your families and your parents and your grandparents and everything they did to give you the opportunities that you had, then you can't be stopped. When you decide change is going to happen, change happens. When you decide that we're moving forward, we move forward. That's what you taught me in 2008. And you know, some of you remember that campaign. I told you, I'm not a perfect man. Michelle told you that too. I told you I wouldn't be a perfect president. But what I told you was, I'd always tell you what I thought. I'd always tell you where I stood.
Yeah.
And I would spend every single day that I had the privilege of having this office thinking about you and fighting as hard as I knew how to make your life. I believe in you.
Yeah.
And I hope you still believe in me.
Yeah.
And I fought for you. And I'm going to keep on fighting for you as long as I have a chance to be your president. And you're willing to stand up with me. I've got horses. Make phone calls. Get out and organize. And we'll finish what we started in 2008. America's the greatest nation on earth.
Yeah. on the way.
Hey, wait.
How you doing?
The Secret Service asked us to push everyone back 50 feet from the roadway, kind of about even with the trees there, so the president has a safe exit out of here. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarge.
Sorry about the clothes, you're going to have to get up on the grass behind the sidewalk. Up on the grass behind the sidewalk for us.
Grass behind the sidewalk.
He gets a pedicure after today, right?
Actually, he gets pedicure gummers all the time. Pay more attention to grooming than life.
Thank you.
Go. Woo!